You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to our final session of Critical Reasoning, Philosophy 120. I'm Dr. Robert Cubijos, coming to you from the DH Television Studios at the Cal State University, Dominguez Hills. And it's been quite a semester. We've covered quite a bit of territory, and as we said at the beginning of the semester, we're going to skip over Chapter 3 and come and turn back around and hit that here at the end of the semester. So the entirety of our time today will be devoted to Chapter 3. But as usual, we want to touch on some housekeeping items before we jump into the lecture. And I would be remiss if I didn't thank the number of folks in the booth that have made this a seamless effort. And it may look pretty easy from your and my end, but behind the scenes, there's quite a bit of effort, quite a bit of activity, quite a few complex things that need to take place. So I'd like to thank Van Bridgman and Dr. Joyce Jones, but especially Calvin, Zanea, Mario, and Derek. These are folks that have made me look a lot better than I actually am in real life, and a lot better in this setting than in the classroom. So thank you to everybody there in the booth. Dealing with Chapter 3, what we're going to be focusing on is informal fallacies, but I'm already jumping ahead too quickly here. I'd like to direct our attention as part of the housekeeping to some announcements on Blackboard. And so if we could go to the computer screen, I need to remind you of the course evaluation. In your inbox, your Toro webmail, you will see a link that was emailed to you in your inbox. You need to complete this evaluation of me and this course by the deadline, which is December 15th. And you need to do that actually much sooner than that, if you could, please. So do not forget the PTE, the Perceived Teaching Effectiveness. You need to go to your inbox and complete that. Also, there was a problem with the number of maximum points on critical reasoning response number 2. It was listed as 15. Many of you were receiving full points, 10, and it looked like it was 10 out of 15. That's been corrected now. It's 10 out of 10. The maximum points is 10, not 15. Next item is the Chapter 3 homework for points. That's already up and running. Even though we'll finish that this afternoon, the homework for points for this chapter is due midnight, Wednesday, December 10th. That's 1 week from today. Homework for points opportunities was only available for chapters 1, 2, 4, and now chapter 3. Also, the third critical reasoning response has been up for almost a week. That critical reasoning response is due tonight, December 3rd at midnight, having to do with natural deduction. Please make sure you get that done as soon as possible so you're not up against the deadline tonight at midnight. Also, the guidelines for your critical reasoning paper, those are available under the critical reasoning paper on Blackboard. We went through that last week. If you have any questions, refer back to the broadcast last week. The due date for the critical reasoning paper is midnight, December 10th, 2015. That's the same deadline for the final exam. Also, the sample final exam is available in the study guides folder in Blackboard. If you've not already done it, you want to print it out. Do not look at the last page where the answer key is at. Try your hand at it and see how well you do. A number of these problems will be on the actual final exam. And I will be posting an announcement about the final exam, but why don't I just go in and take a moment to tell you a little bit about it. It is 50 questions, each question worth 2 points, therefore it's 100 points. You'll have 2 hours to take this online test, and you'll have two attempts, two opportunities to take it, so you can check the gradebook and see how well you've done. It is the second of the two tests that is actually scored and kept in the gradebook. Even if you received a higher grade at your first attempt. All of the PowerPoint slides have been uploaded now into the content section of Blackboard. You'll want to review those. You'll want to make sure you've got your arms around the concepts, make sure you're up on your reading, and then have all that available to you as you dive into the final exam. So that is up and running. You'll want to take that before next Wednesday at midnight. So we're talking about informal fallacies here at Chapter 3. We need to be able to detect these informal fallacies, and we'll do that by examining the content of the arguments. The thing that's important to understand about these informal fallacies is that they engender within us certain emotions. They appeal to our emotions. Sometimes they appeal to our fear, or they appeal to our pity, or they appeal to our camaraderie with others. Or by discrediting an opposing argument, by associating it with various dispositions, is another way that these arguments tend to work. But it's a sign of mental laziness if we allow these arguments to hook us. Also, having passed this course, you do not want to use these informal fallacies in an accidental way in a debate setting or in your papers or in your speaking. So we need to be able to identify and understand what informal fallacies are. We will also be going through some videos to identify what these are. And the first thing that we will do is step into our question of the day, give you an opportunity for some participation points. And so the question of the day is, citizens stealing food to survive, what would you do? So in this following video, we're going to witness some senior citizens that are stuffing their coat, stuffing their jacket with random products in an attempt to steal without paying. Apparently, they do this only in desperation to survive because they can't afford it. But will people turn a blind eye, or will they rat them out? What would you do? Take a look at this video and we'll chat about it. Here we go.
Weekday morning at Matson's, a family-owned supermarket in Burlington, New Jersey, and shoppers are looking for bargains. But there's one elderly shopper who isn't worried about what things cost. He's shoplifting.
Did I just see that?
We all remember that Seinfeld episode.
I saw you steal.
Oh, they don't care. We all do it.
Oh, criminals?
Senior citizens.
And it's not just fiction. With the weak economy making times difficult, shoplifting among the elderly is on the rise. So we wonder, what would happen if our senior citizens weren't just looking for the best deal, but were spotted taking a five-finger discount? We set up hidden cameras in the supermarket to see what would happen. This senior shopper is an actor, hired by us, and so is the manager.
Bin to the bin, please.
This shopper appears not to notice the crime in progress, even as it unfolds right in front of him. He walks right on by. But when we catch up with him, it turns out he was doing a little acting himself. He'd seen everything.
It looked like he took a can of something. And then after that, he took something else. And I kind of felt pathetic for him that he to do this. I know it's wrong not to report him, but I don't like to be a snitch.
We introduced the two senior shoppers to one another.
You caught me red-handed. As an old veteran, I was going to appeal to you in case you did say something.
I'm glad you're not really into that situation, that you're an actor.
A few minutes later, this busy shopper doesn't miss a thing. She watches the criminal at work and then immediately jumps into action.
So you take things off the shelf and put them inside your coat.
Do you have any cash that you could help me
with? No, I don't give cash. We do a lot of things for people. Yeah. We have a food
Yeah, party. Anyway, I need to really move on, okay?
Well, you before. Can't because they're waiting for well, someone to come.
Yeah, and that puts me in a very, very awkward position,
no,
okay?
But, you put yourself in an
yeah,
awkward
no,
position.
I,
she
yeah.
tries compassion.
Well,
I feel badly for you. There is help.
Yeah.
Can I have a veterans person get in touch with you?
But this shoplifter is simply interested in a quick escape.
I don't want to be arrested, so please.
When the shoplifter tries to make a run for it, she picks up her bag and runs right after him. Later, we catch up with her.
You're wondering, if you see someone doing something like that, what should you do?
I offered him help.
And a lot of people kind of turned the other way, and you didn't. Why not?
Well, number one, stealing is wrong, and it won't help him if he continues in that path.
So our question of the day, citizens stealing food to survive, what would you do? So there's our 800 number, 800-339-1193. We'd love to hear your voices here at the end of the semester for your participation point, or you can email us at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So please send us in your thoughts. What would you do? Well, let's push on into our subject matter, informal fallacies. These are distinguished from formal fallacies. But let's remind ourselves, what is a fallacy? What is a fallacy? A fallacy is a defect in an argument, right? That consists in something other than false premises alone. A term, a non sequitur, something doesn't follow, is another name for a fallacy. Well, we've talked about formal fallacies also. Recall, a formal fallacy occurs only in deductive arguments and is one that can be identified by examining the form of the argument. If it has the form of modus ponens, modus tollens, or the disjunctive syllogism, or the pure hypothetical syllogism, or if it has one of the forms on the list of unconditionally valid forms, or the list of conditionally valid forms. If it follows one of those forms, then it's automatically valid. If it doesn't follow the form, it is a fallacy, formal fallacy. Well, let's move into informal fallacies. These are those fallacies that can be detected only by examining the content of the argument. They involve defective patterns of arguing so often that some have even been given their own name. Basically, the semantic relationship, the relationship between one word and another word in a statement, appears to or actually misleads us to conclude that the argument is valid, when in fact it's invalid. There are some 22 informal fallacies that can be grouped into five groups, and you see them listed here. There are fallacies of relevance, fallacies of weak induction, fallacies of presumption, fallacies of ambiguity, and then finally, fallacies of grammatical analogy. We're going to try our best to go through each of these and give you an example of them. At the end of the broadcast, I'll tell you which ones you're actually responsible for in preparation for the and actually taking the final exam. Common to this first set, the fallacies of relevance, those in this first group, are arguments, the arguments in which they occur have premises that are logically irrelevant, logically unrelated to the conclusion. The premises appear to be psychologically relevant without following logically. The connection between the premises and the conclusion is more emotional than anything. And at this point, let me give you a helpful hint. If the connection between the premises and the conclusion is an argument that is really more emotional than anything else, then all we need to do is to be able to distinguish genuine evidence from the form of emotional appeal that we're given. So let's start out with the first group, the fallacies of relevance, and jump right into the first example, which is the appeal to force. Its Latin name is the argumentum ad baculum, the appeal to the stick, but you don't have to memorize these fallacies and their Latin names. And this occurs whenever an arguer poses a conclusion to another person that tells the other person that either implicitly or explicitly some harm is going to come to him or her if she does not or he does not accept the conclusion. This is one of the favorite arguments of the immature. Take a look at the cartoon that you've got on the screen in front of you, and you notice this thug in an alleyway that's pulled aside some innocent bystander that was just walking by. And he says in his argument that Budweiser tastes good. It's the best. That's his argument. And you see the response of the innocent bystander. Yes, I see your point. Do you notice the knife that he's holding at his throat? You see the knife? The threats are logically irrelevant to the subject matter or the conclusion. So any argument that's based upon this procedure is defective, even if the threats are psychological. And that's how you find, and that's how we understand the appeal to force fallacy to work. Let me jump into some of the responses that are beginning to come in. This is Janisha. Hope you're doing well. And it's good to hear back from you here. If I saw someone stealing food to survive, she says, I don't think that there is much that I could do. Frankly, if they don't have the money to survive and have resorted to the final straw of stealing, they're in a very place financially, a very bad place financially. It's not my business, but as a good Samaritan, I may try to talk him out of it, like the lady in the video, and suggest other options, such as food banks. Good. If I was able to talk him out of it, I would probably buy him a meal or something from a nearby fast food restaurant. That's an act of a good Samaritan. Janisha, we thank you for that. And it looks like Noah has also started to give us something here. Let me see if we can jump to that. Thank you, Noah, for your response. We appreciate that. I would approach the shoplifter and try to get him or her to stop stealing. There are places such as senior centers and food pantries where food is given away to people in need. If that person does not stop, I talk to the store manager. Also, I have a question. Regarding the due date for critical response number 3, under the tab Critical Reasoning Responses, it says it's due December 7th, but on the announcements, it says that it's due today. Noah, thank you so much. I appreciate your question. Let me respond in this fashion. Whenever I make a mistake on the due dates, I always give the furthest deadline out that's standing away from us as the default due date whenever I make a mistake. So I don't want to penalize those that are confused by this. So I will make sure that that is up and running through the 7th midnight. And I so appreciate, Noah, you bringing that to my attention. Thank you. We'll take care of that. Mike is responding in. Mike, how are you doing? Thank you so much for your emails. If I saw someone stealing, I would talk to a manager or someone who worked there and tell them. If I couldn't do that, I would confront them and warn them against what they are doing, that it's against the law, and that it isn't worth going to jail for. Ah, interesting. I would let them know that there are places to get food if they're facing tough times. But stealing isn't the answer. Yeah, you don't want to go to jail over a little package of Top Ramen, right? Very good. Okay, so we've gone through our first of the informal fallacies, the appeal to force. And again, any kind of physical or psychological, even the threat of force, does not provide evidence that the conclusion is true. All it does is say that somebody might be injured in the process. Well, let's push on to the appeal to pity. The appeal to pity. This fallacy occurs when an arguer attempts to support a conclusion by merely evoking pity from the reader or from the listener. It's often used by students on professors. It's used on boyfriends, on girlfriends, and girlfriends on boyfriends. It's also used by attorneys on jurors on behalf of their client to try and get the jury to feel pity for them. So they invite them to a pity party. So if you look at the cartoon, you see that not only did he murder our thug that was in the alley, did he murder the bystander, but he's also murdered his mother. And so the attorney argues for him, how can you convict this man of murdering his mother? He's an orphan. Well, it goes without saying, does it not, that if he's murdered her, then he is now motherless, which makes him an orphan. Well, does that mean that he should not be tried for murder because he's an orphan and we should feel pity for him? No, to argue in that fashion is the appeal to pity. And our feelings about someone have no bearing on the logical conclusion that the premises give in support of that conclusion. So the logger's argument is we feel pity for the accused. Therefore, he cannot be guilty of murder. Because the conclusion is supported by nothing other than and nothing more than our pity for the accused. Arguing in this way, the lawyer is guilty of committing the appeal to pity. It's also referred to as the argumentum ad misericordiam. It's fallacious. Subjective feelings have nothing to do with conclusions. Let's push on to the third, the appeal to the people. Appeal to the people. Why don't we let Mr. Spock of Star Trek fame explain the basic tenet of this fallacy? Let's turn now to a cartoon with Mr. Spock and Star Trek. Here you go.
Or you think the captain is going to put in for shore leave?
It'll be Wrigley's pleasure planet.
What makes you think that?
I don't think. I know. Because everyone on deck 6 and 7 thinks so. They can't all be wrong, can they?
Well, I don't know.
Excuse me, gentlemen. I couldn't help overhearing. Yes, sir? The argument you are employing, helmsman, is not logical. In fact, it exhibits the fallacy of argumentum ad populum, also known as appeal to the majority.
The argument seems to make sense.
That may be so, Lieutenant, but the form of the argument is invalid. Your argument exhibits the fallacy of attempting to prove a conclusion on the grounds that all or most people think or believe it is true. The main problem with arguments using this fallacy is the fact that many people agreeing on something does not prove what they all agree on is true. Belief is not proof even if many, many people believe. You use this fallacy with your statement that we are going to spend shore leave on Wrigley's pleasure planet because everyone on deck 6 and 7 believed that we were.
Thank you, Mr. Spock.
Yes, I should rethink what I'm trying to say. That would be best. Even if an argument seems to make sense, it cannot be valid unless the form is valid and that it does not exhibit one of the logical fallacies such as argumentum ad populum, the appeal to the majority. It's only logical.
So, this is the first of our argumentum ad populum. There's several variations that are covered in the textbook. Let's go on and push through and take a look at a couple of versions of these. First is the appeal to people, the direct approach. And in the argumentum ad populum, this always appears in the guise of the desire to be loved, the desire to be esteemed, the desire that many people have to be valued and accepted by others. That influences the reader or the listener to accept a conclusion. In the direct approach, the speaker uses a mob mentality, essentially whooping the group up into an ecstatic frenzy such that they're ready to buy any kind of a conclusion. Probably one of the masters at this is Hitler. Here you see him in Nuremberg giving some of his speeches. And the emotions of the crowd to win acceptance for the conclusion or his or her conclusion is what's going on. In the appeal to the people, the direct approach of speaker creates this mob mentality, but the argument's fallacious because the fact that a speaker created a mob mentality is logically irrelevant to whether the cause or the prescribed action should be taken. And the interesting thing about the genius of Hitler is that he takes a small, war-torn, economically ragtag country and brings it one step away from global domination. And it takes us and our allies to go and take care of his business. But a master at the argumentum ad populum, getting people to believe a conclusion that does not follow from premises. The conclusion doesn't follow just because the mob does. And you probably remember growing up, driving the car, you see some people on the side of the road doing some crazy things, maybe walking in the middle of the street, and mom or dad were always ready to say, even if you saw 100 people walking the street, doesn't mean that you would, right? Mom and dad may have something to say about critical reasoning, right? Oh, well, let's push on to the appeal to the people, the indirect approach. This is the bandwagon variety, the bandwagon variety. Remember the general appeal to the argument to the people fallacy. It occurs when the desire to be loved, esteemed, or valued and accepted by others influences the reader or the listener to accept a conclusion. In the indirect approach, the arguer aims his or her appeal at one or more people, focusing on some aspect of their relationship to the crowd. So look at these beautiful people in the slide behind you. They're absolutely beautiful, right? Gorgeous, handsome. Well, you want to be like that too, don't you? Well, here's how you do it. Buy and use Crest. After all beautiful people use it. You should too. All beautiful people use Crest. You should be using it too. It appeals to our desire to be esteemed and loved and be beautiful. And lots of people on Madison Avenue that are in the marketing firms of these glitzy Madison Avenue corporations, they know just how to hook our emotions on the television so that the next time we go to the supermarket, we're ready to buy that. Well, here's also another example. If you look at our slide, you notice that the thug that got out of prison is now at a tailor shop. And notice how people are wearing their coats and their pant legs. They have this extra amount of material, like a train, coming behind it. Well, the conclusion that he should wear his clothes the way that everybody else does doesn't necessarily follow just because everybody else is doing it. And the salesman says down here, that's the way they're wearing them, sir. Well, the premise is logically irrelevant to the conclusion. Just because everybody's doing it does not mean that he should too. Let's go on to another variety of the indirect approach and talk about the vanity version of the indirect approach of the argument to the people. The appeal to vanity associates the product with someone who is admired, someone who is pursued, somebody that our culture or the public wants to imitate. The idea being that you too will be admired or pursued if you use it. So take a look at the slide here. There's a thread that is common in each slide, and you've probably seen it, right? The guy's holding a Budweiser. How do you get the girl? You have a Budweiser as you approach her. You want to be pretty like the gal here? Make sure you've got your Budweiser within reach. And let's talk about how cool these guys are over here in our next video in just a moment. The indirect approach doesn't aim at the appeal at the crowd, but at one or more individuals separately, focusing on some aspect of their relationship to the crowd. Watch how this is done in a Budweiser commercial. Bud serves as a unifying point and contributes to the sense of identity of these men. Watch this video. You'll probably remember it.
Hello? Hey, who? What's up? Nothing, B. Just watching the game, having a bud. What's up with you?
Nothing. Watching the game, having a bud.
True. True.
What's up?
Yo, who's that?
Yo, you're picking the phone.
Hello?
What's that?
What's up?
Yo, where's Dookie?
Yo, Dookie!
Yo.
What's up?
What's that?
Hold on. Hello?
So what's up, B?
Watching the game, having a bud.
True. True.
Hello?
Yo, who's that?
Yo, it's D.
True. Hello?
Yo, it's T.
True.
I've got a theory. Some of you have studied the theories and the psychology, maybe, of the great social psychologist Abraham Maslow and his hierarchy of needs. On this pyramid, everybody shares in humanity the very base needs of survival, food and water, and we move up to the next level once those are satisfied, of security and safety. Well, at the very top of this pyramid, and yeah, these overlap, is the point when we reach our own self-identification, our self-realization. And apparently, through Budweiser beer, these guys have realized who they are. Their identity is found in their camaraderie. That camaraderie is facilitated by Budweiser. And of course, it's a multi-billion dollar industry that we all support because we want to be esteemed, loved, and have that point of contact with our friends. So let's push on. This is not too much different from the appeal to vanity, which often associates our use with a product with identity creation. There's a slide that shows that cigarettes do pretty much the same thing, right? Right? There's even a movie about Harley Davidson and the Marlboro Man. Here's the image of the last of the radical individualist Americans, right? Nobody tells him what to do. He's one tough hombre. Nobody messes with him. That's what this guy's trying to do over here, right? This is the appeal to vanity. And having a cigarette in your mouth sometimes does that for some people. Well, there's also in the indirect approach, in the appeal to people, there is the snobbery approach within the indirect approach. And the way that this works is the appeal to snobbery is the same kind of association, but addresses people who think that they're already part of the in crowd. So on our next cartoon, you see two men in the back of a cart that are going to visit Monsieur le Guillotine over here during the French Revolution. They're going to have their heads chopped off. This is the time when the River Seine, flowing through the middle of Paris, ran red with blood for months. And the gal is saying, don't forget me. Don't forget me. I want to be part of this. And the two ladies up here in the blocked off area say, apparently, they're taking everyone who is anyone. So she wants to be part of the group. Little does she know, she's going to go get her head chopped off. But that doesn't matter to her. What's more important is appealing to her snobbery, that she is part of the in crowd. Both the direct and the indirect forms of appeal to the people is this. You don't want to be left out of the crowd. Therefore, you will do whatever the crowd is doing. On this slide, you see that if you use Adidas, you know, you're one of these sports figures. And, you know, you know your game, you play your game hard, and you wear this cologne, it signifies you as a hard player. Here's the great director, filmmaker, Robert Townsend, who drives a Lincoln. You drive a Lincoln, you'll be pursued, esteemed, and admired just like him. That's the idea behind Madison Avenue's pitch to us. And also, if you wear Davidoff, A Cool Woman, I think is the name of it, the Eau de Toilette, literal toilet water out of the French, you will look just like this lady, be pursued and admired by your friends. So whether it's sports and wanting to be a winner, Adidas like the cologne you wear, that's the cologne you want, you're a winner, or looking beautiful like the model in the picture because of the perfume that you wear, which contributes to your beautiful essence, or being famous, or at least treated like somebody who's famous, like Robert Townsend, because of the car you drive, we're all motivated now to purchase these types of products. Well, let's talk about another iteration of the appeal. Excuse me, we're moving to the argument against the person. Argument against the person, this is the fourth. The argumentum ad hominem has certain specific characteristics. First off, it always takes place between two people. Either one advances a certain argument and the other person responds by directing his or her attention not to the argument, but to the person himself or herself that launched or brought out that first or the original argument. It boils down to this tactic. The person who is responding should be responding to the argument, but can't, and instead responds to the person. It boils down, if you can't attack the argument, attack the arguer. If you can't attack the argument, attack the arguer. Well, we know it's fallacious because you've now redirected your concentration away from the argument that you should be responding to in a debate or on a paper, and you've said something about the person who rolled out the argument. Well, the first variety of several that we'll look at is the argumentum against the person, the abusive variety. Instead of responding to a person's argument, the other person responds by verbally abusing the first person. The theory is you're bad, so your argument must be bad, which of course is fallacious. Well, take a look at this next video where a pro-choice feminist commits the ad hominem fallacy and she doesn't even realize that she did it. Watch this and we'll make some comments.
At the risk of sounding too radical, I suppose, I think it's really interesting that every time I've been asked to debate this issue, I've been debating a man, right, for this question. And I wanted to sort of point out the obvious, because the question of whether or not abortion should be legal is actually a question that will never have to be answered in terms of a man's life or a man's body. So when we think about you know, how easy it is to perhaps champion for the unborn when it's not your body, it's not your career, it's not your life that's at stake. And even further, the ways in which there are plenty of women who end up aborting fetuses at the request of their partners, male partners.
Well, I would just say I actually think that it is sexist to discount my position because I'm a man, that you can have so you can have a position on an issue that doesn't directly affect you. For example, Professor Chadwick probably opposes a military draft, even though she won't be drafted because she's a woman. So you can oppose an issue that doesn't affect you if you understand it's an issue of injustice.
Excellent response, right? So she committed the fallacy of ad hominem abusive by saying every time, interestingly, I get up and talk about this, I'm always confronted with a man. And men can't talk about this because the choice rests with a woman. So the fact that he's a man, essentially saying he can't contribute anything to the argument, he's steamrolled right over him, holding his sexuality or his gender against him, and saying that he cannot say anything about the conclusion. Well, gender has nothing to do with the conclusion. The premises either support or do not support the validity of the conclusion. Gender has nothing to speak about that, but that's the point that that she wanted to make. Well, let's push on to a reminding about the question of the day, citizens stealing food to survive, what would you do? And we just put up our 800 number and our email address. I'd encourage you to respond before the break here so you can get your participation points in. And let's go ahead and push into the argument against the person. This is the circumstantial. The first one was abusive. Now we're talking about the circumstantial variety. This is the second instance of ad hominem arguments. Instead of verbal abuse, circumstantial variety has the respondent attempting to discredit an opponent's argument by alluding to certain circumstances that affect the opponent. The following video provides us with some great examples of this and other types of ad hominem arguments. Take a look at this video about the ad hominem argument against the person or against the man, and you'll see how these work. Take a look at this video.
Ad hominem is a Latin phrase meaning literally to the man. It refers to a logical fallacy, or in other words, a bad argument. Ad hominem is when someone uses a personal attack as an argument. This takes many forms, four of which will be covered in this video. the first is the abusive form. For example, John argues that because dark chocolate has antioxidants and most other candies only have sugar, which rots your teeth, dark chocolate is therefore better than most sweets. Tim responds to this argument,
"Yeah, but you're a greedy jerk."
Whatever John's moral character may be, Tim's response is not an argument. John may in fact be a greedy jerk, but that doesn't make him wrong. Another more common variant of this is the circumstantial form. For example, if Tim were to respond to John's argument saying,
"Yeah, but you work for the chocolate company. You're paid to say that."
John may have been paid to make the argument, but that doesn't address the argument he was making. Now, if Tim were to respond to John's argument,
"Yeah, but I saw you eating a candy cane,"
this would be an example of the third variant of ad hominem, called tu quoque, which is Latin for "you also." Being a hypocrite does not invalidate an argument. The fourth and final form of ad hominem is the guilt by association. This would be if Tim responded to John by saying,
"Nazis also believed dark chocolate was better,"
implying that, holding this belief, John is as bad as a Nazi. That still is not an argument. John may in fact be a Nazi, but that doesn't automatically make him wrong. It certainly doesn't address the issue at hand. Just remember, a personal attack is not an argument. So the next.
All right, so very helpful information there about the argumentum ad hominem. Notice that the video has got four versions of it. Our textbook only has the three, the abusive, the circumstantial, and the tu quoque, the you too, or the hypocritical version. So you want to be able to identify these, and folks, as always, you want to make sure that you're up on your reading, you understand the concepts, and hopefully what we've touched on here helps you with some of those finer points that might be a little difficult for you to understand. Let's push on into the fifth of the informal fallacies that we'll want to cover, which is the informal fallacy called accident. This fallacy is committed when a general rule is applied to a specific case that it was not intended to cover. A general rule applied in a specific case that it wasn't intended to cover. Typically, the general rule is cited either directly or indirectly in the premises, and then the conclusion is applied to the specific case that's mentioned in the conclusion. You see in the following slide, where a Colonel Smith had given instructions to his troops to go and attack the enemy that's on the other side of the valley, and notice that they're all falling dead, and everybody on the enemy side is intact. Well, it says up here in the caption, if you can't read it, that Colonel Smith was slow to realize that the shoot till you see the whites of their eyes was not always a successful attack strategy. His troops literally waited till they got close enough to see the eyes, and they were shot as they were progressing. These were shooting as soon as they got within range. And so the specific case of the whites of their eyes was applied in a military case, and Colonel Smith was slow to realize that that's not a good type of strategy. He's committed the fallacy of accident. It's similar to the reasoning that's reflected in the following argument. You, as a group of young scholars, might say, "Hey, it's the end of the semester. Let's party at Dr. Cabijos' house." My wife would say, "He's busy on a project. No, you can't come over." And you, young scholars, might argue in response, "Too bad. The Bill of Rights guarantees us the right to assemble," at which point I would have to insert, "Your argument is fallacious, class, because the Bill of Rights does not apply to assemblies in private homes. Also, the premise is logically irrelevant to your conclusion." Nice try anyway, young scholars. Nice try anyway. And I wish that we could have a end of the semester party. That would be lots of fun. Well, let's push on to the sixth of the informal fallacies. This is called the straw man argument, the straw man fallacy. This fallacy is committed when the arguer distorts the original argument with the intention that he can or she can demolish this distorted version, and he or she believes that what she has done is to take care of or demolish the original argument, when in fact all she's done or he's done is to demolish the distorted variety. Take a look at this slide. Here's young Johnny sitting at the table, and you see he's got a variety of food here on his plate, and he says, "I hate spinach, Mom." His subject, the topic he's talking about, is not the contents of his plate, only spinach. Notice what his mom says. "You hate spinach. You'll starve if you don't eat. Now, eat your spinach." The subject is spinach. She has taken it to mean the entirety of everything on his plate. He has to eat everything and the spinach, or he will starve. No, he's not going to starve if he eats everything but the spinach. So that's the argument of the straw man. Argument has to do with spinach. The mother distorts the argument into one of starvation. Her conclusion is that if he doesn't eat, he's going to starve. Her strategy is, if you can't attack an argument, substitute a new one in its place, demolish that argument, and you've demolished the argument, when in fact that's an error. That's got nothing to do with the original argument. The telltale sign of straw man is the distorted argument is usually more extreme than the original argument. Let's move on to the seventh of our informal fallacies, which is missing the point. Missing the point. All the fallacies thus far that we've looked at are instances of cases where the premises of an argument are irrelevant to the conclusion. Missing the point is a special form of relevance, of irrelevance. Missing the point fallacy occurs when the premises of an argument support one conclusion, one particular conclusion, but then a different conclusion that's vaguely related to the original or the correct one is drawn. Here's an example. One of my students, Tracy, argues, "Critical reasoning is so hard. Too difficult. I'll never get an A. So I'm going to blow it off and settle for a D." The conclusion logically implied by the premises is that Tracy should continue trying as hard as she can, doing her studies, and maybe she can earn a B instead of an A. But her conclusion is illogical. She's missed the point. Okay, let's push on to number 8, the red herring fallacy. Red herring fallacy. This fallacy is committed when the arguer diverts attention of the reader or listener by changing the subject to a different but sometimes subtly related subject. The arguer then finishes by either drawing a conclusion about this different issue or by merely resuming that some conclusion has been established. By this, the arguer purports to have won the argument. Well, the fallacy gets its name from these oily fish called herring. And originally, they were used to train hunting dogs. These fish would be placed in a burlap sack and drug all over various trails where an original scent of what was being hunted was drug. And only the best dogs would follow the original scent. They would not be thrown off by the smell of this oily fish. That's where the red herring fallacy gets its name. I've got a trivia question here, and hopefully we're not going to offend any dog lovers. How were dogs originally used in hunting? Have you thought about that? How dogs were originally used in hunting? Well, this next cartoon shows you. They were used in catapults and thrown at what was being hunted. I hope that that's not too offensive. I had thought about using a dead cat cartoon. How many of you have seen the book 101 Uses for Dead Cats? There is a dead cat toast holder where you set the cat on the table and the toast goes in between the four legs that are up. But we're not going to go there. Folks, you might want to try some of the exercises in section 3.2 that begin on page 133. That's page 133 in your text. And also, all of these arguments have a very nice summary on page 195 of your textbook and following. So you'll want to take note of those two page numbers. page 133 and following to try your hand at some of these sample exercises, and then page 195 for a summary of the exercises. On that note, before we take a brief break, let's do a few sample problems and see how you are coming along with this. Take a look at this next slide. The slide reads, you really ought to vote for Jane Barker for Senate. Poor Jane, adversity for life, born in poverty, she's got no kids and has diabetes. What kind of fallacy is being committed here in this style of argument? How many of you would go with appeal to force? How many of you would say argumentum ad misericordium, appeal to pity? Is this an argument to the people? Go ahead and log in your choice and we'll flip the side and see what the right answer is. And on the next slide, you'll see that it is the appeal to pity. It's probably what you chose. Let's push on to the next sample problem, which reads as follows. Pete, I'm certain you'll want to give me those concert tickets. Now, you don't want the dean to know about your term paper, do you? How many of you would say that's the appeal to force? Doesn't sound like there's any pity going on, so we would not choose the second one. Appeal to the people, is that a possibility? What would your choice be? Think about that. Let's flip the side and see what our answer is. That's right, it's appeal to force because Pete is being threatened by disclosure that the dean would know about his term paper. And lastly, we've got one more. Let's read that slide and see if you could come up with an answer for that sample problem. The next one reads, Jane, I can't believe you don't have a cell phone yet. Why, practically everybody today has one. Surely you'll buy one now. Well, we don't detect the appeal to force argumentum ad baculum, nor the argumentum ad misericordium. How about appeal to the people? Yeah, that seems to fit. Everybody, right? Today has one. It's the desire to be like everybody. Appeal to the people. Very good. Well, let's talk about the fallacies of weak induction. Actually, let me take a look at the time here and see if maybe we can... let's go on ahead and do the second question of the day and then push into our break. I don't know if we can go on ahead and advance to that. And the question for the second question of the day is, what is an example of an informal fallacy you recently heard someone commit? Think about that. Let's go ahead and take our break, and then you can give me your responses here in the second half of our broadcast. Let's go ahead and take our break. We'll see you in about 5 minutes, folks.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi. I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. You have to want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Del Toro!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
You are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
All right, we've got six more to move for this next group of the five. Fallacies that are informal in nature. We're looking at the form internal to the argument, the content. And so often it's related more to the language that's used and various types of emotional appeals. Well, next are the fallacies of weak induction. And as we have talked about before, induction means probability. So weak induction would be very low probability that the conclusion follows from the premises. These are not because premises are logically irrelevant to the conclusion, like the fallacies of relevance, but because the connection between the premises and the conclusion is weak. The evidence in these next six isn't good enough to cause a reasonable person to believe the conclusion. Like the fallacies of relevance, however, fallacies of weak induction or low probability involve an emotional type of appeal or grounds, emotional grounds for believing the conclusion. So the next one is the appeal to an unqualified authority. we think, well, he's an authority, and if he's speaking about something, we should probably believe him. But maybe the thing that he's talking about, he is unqualified for. So on our slide, we see James Johnson. He's the chairman and CEO of the RJR Reynolds Tobacco Company, part of Big Tobacco. You see him over here with the other heads, seven heads of Big Tobacco, testifying in front of Congress that cigarette smoking doesn't produce any addiction. Each of the seven dwarves, each of these seven guys got up and said, I don't think that cigarette smoking causes addiction. Well, because he, like the others, are the head of a tobacco giant, we may draw the conclusion that since he's a bigwig, we can believe him. And maybe he's an authority in the industry. But in addition to being an unqualified authority, he's not a pharmacologist. He doesn't have any kind of a degree or background in biochemistry or anything like that. He also has a conflict of interest. If he admitted that tobacco is addictive, he would have brought big government and its regulation into his company. And that probably would have put his company out of business. So because Johnson had a motivation to lie, we shouldn't believe his statements. Well, let's turn our attention away from the informal fallacies and take a look at some of the responses that are starting to come in. Look like Noah's first up. Noah, thank you again. Good to hear from you. Noah said, you should go to the school event this Saturday because you've never gone to one before. Plus, everyone else is going. It'll be lots of fun. Argumentum ad populum, right? And probably the bandwagon variety. Noah, very good. And for those of you that are about to respond, see if you can identify the fallacy that you're referring to that you had heard. So give an example of an informal fallacy that you recently heard and name the fallacy if you're able to. Noah, good job. Thank you for that. Very good. We're at number 10. Of the 22 informal fallacies. This is the appeal to ignorance. The appeal to ignorance. This fallacy occurs when the premises of an argument state that nothing has been proved one way or the other about something, and that then the conclusion makes a definite statement about that very thing. The issue usually involves something that is incapable of being proved or something that has not yet been proved. Going to our slide, we'll take a look at the example that we use having to do with astrology. Astrology, right? And the claim is often that people have been trying for centuries to disprove the claims of astrology and no one has ever succeeded. Thus, we must conclude that the claims of astrology are true. Well, premises are to provide evidence for a conclusion. These premises tell us nothing in this argument about astrology. Unnamed or unidentified sources or people are not sufficient reasons to believe that something that is claimed to be true is in fact true. That is to fall prey to the appeal to ignorance. Argumentum ad ignorantium. Let's push on to the 11th one. This is hasty generalization. A lot of this, especially in the press, and sometimes we fall prey to this, sometimes we commit it ourselves. Let's be on guard that we don't commit this. This fallacy occurs when there is a reasonable likelihood that the sample is not representative of a large group. We take a small group and believe that that's representative of a much larger group when in fact all we're doing is hastily making a generalization about the whole after only looking at a part of the whole. This likelihood may occur if the sample is either too small or it's not randomly selected. Let's go to our slide and read the example. We heard this, right? 10 Arab fundamentalists hijacked planes and crashed them into the World Trade Center in New York City. The message is clear. Arabs are nothing but a pack of religious fanatics prone to violence. That is not necessarily the case. To argue in this fashion is to commit the fallacy of hasty generalization. Hasty generalization. So you folks see how that's working. Let's remind our viewers, our young scholars, of the prompt, the question of the day. We're asking for an example of an informal fallacy that you recently heard someone commit. And we'd like you to also name, if you can, the fallacy. If you can't, that's fine. I'll try my hand in categorizing it. How's that? Call in or email in so you can get those participation points. Well, we're at false cause, number 12, false cause. The fallacy of false cause occurs whenever the link between the premises and the conclusion depends on some imagined causal connection that probably does not exist. Let's go to our cartoon and see what we're talking about. Here's young Mary sitting with the rest of the family in the living room, and she asks Dad the question, Dad, do you store your socks flat or rolled up? Picture in your mind, when he puts his socks in his sock drawer, are they rolled up or does he lay them flat? That's what she wants to know. Well, Dad responds, flat. Why? Now watch Mom's response here on the next slide. Well, young Mary says, this says that as people grow older, they tend to store their socks flat rather than rolled up. Mom says, maybe you'd feel younger if you rolled your socks up, honey. So she's making a link that if he didn't lay them flat but rolled it up like a lot of younger people are doing, it would make him feel younger. Notice his response. And here I've been wasting my time exercising and eating oat bran. This is the fallacy of false cause. This nothing is going to affect or result in the cause of the way you feel, older or younger, by the folding or the rolling or laying flat of one's socks. That premise and that conclusion doesn't connect. That's a connection that probably doesn't exist. This fallacy occurs whenever a stated causal connection exists when in fact it probably doesn't. Let's go on to number 13. This is the slippery slope argument. And this fallacy occurs when a conclusion of an argument rests upon an alleged chain reaction of events, and there's not sufficient reason to believe that that chain reaction will actually take place. An example could be legalizing marijuana will lead to the legalization of cocaine. And if you legalize cocaine, you'll be able to buy crack and every other drug at your local 7-Eleven. In this argument, it is asserted that legalization of marijuana will lead to, by degrees, the legalization of every other drug. Once you accept the first step, then it is assumed that you're on a slippery slope toward the legalization of every other drug. Well, we've got some cartoons here having to do with privacy rights, and once a Texas law was shot down, there were adults that felt that they had the ability to do anything that they wanted, and other people in society were talking about that. I'll let you read this on your own. In the interest of time, some of these have a lot of dialogue. You can also read the second one on your own, which also continues with the slippery slope type argument. Or maybe we just had one slide for that. Let's talk about weak analogy. Weak analogy is the next one. We're moving out of slippery slope into weak analogy, number 14 out of 22. This occurs, or it's committed, when the analogy is not strong enough to support the conclusion that is drawn. Imagine that you're in a laboratory and you're looking at some entity, maybe it's a chemical compound, and you notice that it has certain attributes A, B, C, and Z as you're looking at entity A. When you get to compound B or entity B, you notice that it has similarly the attributes of A, B, and C. And you conclude, therefore, conclusion indicator word, entity B probably also has attribute Z also. Well, this is a weak analogy. Just because one chemical compound has that it doesn't mean that the other one has to have it. The analogy is not strong enough to support the conclusion that is drawn. Let's move into the fallacies of presumption, the next group of our five groups of informal fallacies. These next three fallacies are called fallacies of presumption. Arguments containing these presume what they are purporting to prove. Premises were logically irrelevant to the conclusion in the first eight, right? And the connection between the premises and the conclusion isn't strong enough to support the conclusion in the fallacies of weak induction, as we just saw. Now we're moving into the fallacies of presumption. The first is begging the question. This fallacy occurs when an arguer creates the illusion that premises provide adequate support by either leaving a premise out, or by restating the conclusion as a premise, or by reasoning in a circle. Let's take a look at our example. Here it reads, binge drinkers eventually sober up. Thus, binge drinking is not a real problem. Well, it's missing a premise. If binge drinkers eventually sober up, then binge drinking is not a problem. That should have gone in here. Because the premise was left out, which may even be false, it commits the fallacy of begging the question. Another version of begging the question is arguing in a circle. Aristotle ethics is the greatest theory. Thus, it contains the most profound insights. Thus, it appeals to the most people. Thus, it influences the most people. Thus, it is the greatest theory. Notice, the greatest theory is where we ended up. That's also the premise that we started with. That's another form of begging the question. It's version three, called arguing in a circle. Give you another example. Why am I so smart? Because I'm so intelligent. Or, as we've talked about earlier this semester, the great propaganda that was in East Germany, Die Lehre von Marx ist allmächtig, weil sie war East, the teaching of Marx are almighty because they are true. The premise says the same thing as the conclusion. So it really provides no support whatsoever for the conclusion. This is to be arguing in a circle or begging the question. Well, let's move into number 16. Of the 22. This is called complex question. This fallacy consists of two questions that are actually embedded in a single question. Listen to this. When did you stop beating your husband? Do you always cheat at cards? If you answer yes, you admit to cheating. If you answer no, then you admit to past cheating. A question that traps the person to whom it's asked into admitting something that she may not want to admit is a complex question. There's a hint, and you see that on the screen. To identify complex question, it's the only fallacy that has a question that asks. It's easy to recognize because it ends with a question mark. But for the fallacy to be committed, the question has to consist of two or more questions. And it has to paint somebody in a corner. Let's talk about false dichotomy, the 17th of the 22. This occurs when the arguer presents two unlikely options as if they were the only ones available. And imagine when you're growing up, you're going to Toys R Us, there is thousands of choices of toys to be made, and of course, mom says what? You can only have this or that. A false dichotomy. Well, there's other things that I might be interested in, mom, and of course, if she says, well, that's within our price range, well, you say, well, there's these others that are in the price range too. So often, false dichotomy is given to us by an arguer, hoping that knowing that either those two choices that they're giving to you are the choices that they prefer. So they're presenting to you two options. and only two options. So take a look at the screen behind us. The example is as follows. Either you invite me to the dance, or you don't deserve to be called my friend, which is the stated premise. Well, of course, you do deserve to be called my friend, which is the implied premise. Therefore, you will invite me to the dance. Well, the argument's fallacious because it creates the illusion that there's only two options available. The person that wants you to take him to the dance wants to go to the dance, when in fact, you could go to the movies, you could do a variety of other things. It's not just going to the dance in order to be continued to be categorized as one's friend. In that conditional statement, either you invite me to the dance or you don't deserve to be called my friend, it's given the appearance that if it is true, when in fact it's probably false, there are other options. A hint about false dichotomy, it always involves a conditional premise, the either or. At least implicitly, the either or. The premise must be false or probably false as well. Let's talk about the 18th, suppressed evidence. Suppressed evidence. An arguer ignores important evidence that requires a different conclusion. Here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, like many other college campuses, there are needs boards or job boards. And the advertisement is made on a piece of paper, it's tacked up on a board, and then there are these little strips or ribbons where the phone number is at. You can rip one off and take one. Imagine that there was an offer for a job that reads as follows. I'm reading from the slide. Typewriter repairmen have earned a good living in the past. Thus, typewriter repairmen will earn a good living in the future. What evidence is the arguer ignoring in his or her argument? Think about that for a moment. Right? The arguer ignores the fact that almost every typewriter has been replaced by a computer. The correct conclusion is that typewriter repairmen will not be making a good earning in future years. A good source for these types of suppressed evidence are changes that have occurred with the passage of time. Let's see if we can try our hand at some other examples and see how you do on some of these. Let's go to our first sample problem. It says, either we develop genetically engineered foods or the human race will starve. The choice should be obvious. Doesn't sound like begging the question, right? It could be suppressed evidence. But we're going to go with probably false dichotomy, right? Because it's just giving two choices, one or the other. And that is correct. That is the answer. We see our yellow check mark there. Let's push on to the next example and see what you folks come up with. Gina, that man I saw you with in the restaurant is very handsome. Tell me, are you still cheating on your husband? What type of fallacy is being committed here? Not really begging the question. Sounds like a complex question. No, we're not going to go with false dichotomy. We'll go with a second choice, right? Let's see if that's the correct answer. And in fact, it is. Well, let's push on into the fallacies of ambiguity. Our next section, fallacies of ambiguity. These arise from the use of ambiguous language, either in the premises or in the conclusion. And the first example of this is equivocation. Equivocation. The fallacy of equivocation occurs when the conclusion of an argument depends on the fact that a word or a phrase is used either explicitly or implicitly in two different senses in the argument. Let's go on ahead and take a look at our sample slide here and explain that. It reads, some triangles are obtuse. Whatever is obtuse is ignorant. Therefore, some triangles, it's concluded, are ignorant. Well, obtuse is being used in two different senses. In the first premise, it describes an angle. In the second, it means dull or stupid. So, Equivocation is when a single word is used in two different senses in an argument. You want to be very careful when you're crafting your arguments and when you're writing that you do not equivocate. And sometimes people actually argue this. You want to be able to identify it in their arguments. Let's talk about amphiboly next. This occurs when an arguer misinterprets an ambiguous statement and then draws a conclusion based on a faulty interpretation. And it reads here, in the example on our slide, yesterday I saw a squirrel looking out of my dorm room window. Well, the question is, the listener says, did it tear up your dorm room? Well, the issue is just who was looking out the window, the squirrel or the arguer? The responder concludes that the squirrel was in the room and looking out. Well, a couple of hints for us. Equivocation arises out of an ambiguity in a word or a phrase that's used by the arguer. And we saw that with the word obtuse. Amphiboly, on the other hand, arises from an ambiguity in a statement that's usually made by someone other than the arguer. That'll hopefully help you be able to identify and distinguish between the two. Well, our last grouping of the five that we were talking about of informal fallacies and their five categorizations, the last are the fallacies of grammatical analogy. The last two fallacies are called fallacies of grammatical analogy because they occur in arguments that are grammatically similar to one another and similar in that they may not be fallacious arguments, when in fact they are. Composition is the first of the two, and now we're on number 21 of the 22 arguments. Composition occurs when it is argued that because the parts have a certain attribute, it follows that the whole has that attribute too, and the situation is such that the attribute in question cannot be legitimately transferred from the parts to the whole. Well, pushing onto our slide to show you the fallacy in practice, the example that we are given here reads as follows. Maria likes anchovies. She also likes chocolate ice cream. Thus, it is certain that she would like a chocolate sundae topped with anchovies. The argument is the parts, the anchovies and chocolate ice cream, are liked by Maria. Therefore, the whole, the mix of these parts, is like too. To reason in that fashion is to commit the fallacy of composition. The argument is fallacious because the arguer has improperly transferred the attribute of being liked by Maria from the parts onto the whole. Just because she likes both separately, the parts, doesn't mean that she would like them together as the whole. That is the fallacy of composition. Fallacy number 22 is the fallacy of division. It occurs when the arguer erroneously transfers an attribute from the whole of something onto the parts. Transferring from the whole onto the parts. Let's move on to our samples that we've got. The first is the exclamation that this jigsaw puzzle, when it's assembled, is circular in shape. Therefore, each piece is circular in shape. Well, not necessarily so. We also have a good example that comes from cooking. Now, how many of you young scholars out there love chicken? You probably love noodles too, and you probably love the French version of Coco Riesling and those Swambian noodles known as spätzle. And if you're above the age of drinking one day, you might even enjoy a nice Gewürztraminer or some of the fine Alsatian Riesling wines along with that. Well, just because the whole is something that is like does not mean that the parts are something that's like. To reason in that fashion is to commit the fallacy of division. And as you look at the next slide, The next slide will give you the reason. Just because you like French food does not mean that you would like Monsieur Escargot here. We've got a snail that's riding a razor, right? Well, if you know anything about French food, you will know that the snail is the vehicle for garlic and butter in Les Escargots. And when I was graduating from California State University, Dominguez Hills, back in 1983, I not only graduated with my business degree, but I also studied for a couple of years with Madame Lunard, one of our French professors here at Dominguez, and was five classes away from taking a Bachelor of Arts in French Studies. And thankfully, I had enough French in me to spend a couple of sessions at the University of Strasbourg in France. And one day, I was enjoying a Cronenberg. The Cronenberg beer is one of the oldest beers. The freeway sign simply reads since 1667, one of the oldest beers. That's the ad for Cronenberg. I'm sitting in the shadows of the Cathedral of Strasbourg enjoying a plate of escargot and a cold Cronenberg beer. And I clamp the third one and I take my two-tined fork, and as I go to retrieve it out of the shell, I notice there's something a little bit different about this snail that the waiter had given to me. And it's the first time at this restaurant, and I had had a few Americans with me, and I had ordered for everybody in French, and he knew I was an American. I took the snail and set it on my plate, and there was a little protrusion that looked like an antenna, and I poked it with one of the tines of the fork, and it withdrew. It was a semi-conscious raw snail that he had served me. Thankfully, Madame Lenard had given us some choice French words, swear words, if you will, that we could use on inattentive maître d'hôtel. I called him over. I pointed out what the waiter had served, and his amazement that I could talk to him in French and use some choice French words, but he took the plate away and brought me something else, but I didn't go back to that restaurant. Folks, we're coming up to the end here. It's been a pleasure to be with you this semester. We will repeat this course if things work out as they are planning here in the fall of 2015. That's not next semester, it's the semester after that. And so it's been a pleasure being your professor. Make sure that you keep an eye on Blackboard for the final announcements. Make sure that you adhere to the deadlines and do your best at the final exam. And the announcement on that and some of the details will be forthcoming. Again, I'd like to thank all the folks here at DHTV that has made this possible for me. Made it a real pleasure to present this broadcast to you. And they've had a tremendous influence on my teaching style here on this broadcast series. And so thanks go out to Van Bridgman. Look forward to working with you again soon, Van. And also to Dr. Joyce. Thank you so much for bringing me on. And also for the key individuals there in the control room, which include Calvin, Zanea, Derek, and Mario. Take care.